So I've been obsessed with the brain for about a decade. And in 2013, as you mentioned, I sold my company, Braintree, and I started Kernel. And what I'm trying to do with Kernel is build the tools that would allow us to read and write our neural code, which is similar to how we've been able to sequence the genome, and we've built tools to be able to edit the genome. And so when I announced Kernel, a lot of people thought the idea was crazy. But I started it because I believe that working on the brain is the single most important thing that we could focus on as a species. And so in this talk, I'd like to tell you why. To level set this discussion, I'd like to do a thought experiment with you. Let's imagine that we're playing a game and that it's halftime. And all of us are team human and the rest of the 7 billion people on this planet. And the first half of the game was a few billion or a few thousand years we had before this, and we're now looking towards the second half. So by show of hands, how many of you are feeling warm and fuzzy that team human is doing a good job and we're winning in the first half? Okay, how many of you are not feeling warm and fuzzy that we didn't do so well in the first half? Okay, so now let's say, looking forward to the second half, how many of you who said you were feeling warm and fuzzy are feeling great about team human for the second half? We got a good plan in place, we're feeling good. Okay, how many of you do not feel warm and fuzzy about the second half of gameplay? Okay, so more. Okay, so the difference about this game is that there is no definitive score. Each one of us assign our own score. And so I personally think the score is tied. And I think that now is a time for us to deeply contemplate how we might enter this new half. So for those of you who said that the world, that the team human is doing well, I think have a lot of data to support your opinions. The world has never been a better place by a lot of data points. Global living standards are up, violence is down. It seems like every day we hear of a new amazing scientific discovery. Those of you who are discouraged about the world also have a lot of data to support you, right? So we have global instability, we have political mayhem, inequality is on the rise. There's a plentiful number of things we might be worried about, climate science. And so with all these contemplations, then the question is, what do we do? Next slide, please. So to baseline myself in this analysis, I decided to get an expert opinion. And so I asked my 7-year-old daughter, Genevieve, what her future concerns would be, and I brought them with me. We'll take a look. So number one, Genevieve said her fear is monsters. Number two, parents dying. Three, Nagini, our snake, coming back to life. And it was sad, we brought Nagini out to play. She was in the bedroom, and she found the smallest little hole in a cabinet. She climbed in. We spent hours drilling holes in the wall in the cabinets. We couldn't recover her. We could smell her for a few months, but anyways, she is now scared of Nagini. And then four, animals taking over the world. Now, at first glance, we look at this, and it's funny, right? Like, we relate to this, and it's cute. But on closer examination, I actually found that my concerns about the future are pretty similar to Genevieve's. And so first, let's take monsters. I'm afraid of monsters, just not the ones that hide under my bed. My father was addicted to drugs for the first 25 years of my life. My stepfather has early symptoms of Alzheimer's, and watching someone lose their humanhood before your eyes is a devastating experience. And I suffered from debilitating depression from age 24 to 34, where in my mind, I was tortured, and I couldn't find a way out. I spent a decade, so first, let's take second one. Previous slide, please. Second, let's take dying. I grew up in a deeply religious family in Utah, where Mormonism was the only reality through which I understood. And I was told that God had a plan, that someone was in charge, we were all taken care of, and that if I obeyed his rules, I would have this wonderful afterlife. And so this singular concern I had in my life was obey the rules. Now, as an adult, I decided to leave the faith. And so the first time I had to confront with a situation that I'd never dealt with before, that I had to now build in this life with my fellow humans any version of heaven which I previously contemplated. So I could no longer say without a doubt that God is in charge, all under control. And with that realization, I thought, okay, well then who is in charge? It must be my fellow humans who are in charge. So with that information, I looked at the history of human civilization and how we treat each other and how we treat this planet. And I thought, uh-oh. Third on the list, a dead snake coming back to life. This is the fear that something unseen will come back and bite us. We know this fear. This is climate change, technology, AI, just to name a few. But not only that, but since we're playing a game here, with winners continuing to exist and those who don't go extinct, the second half of the game we're about to play is gonna be much harder. We don't understand or pay attention to things we cannot see. So when we are paying attention, our systems simply can't work fast enough to keep up. This leaves humans in a reactive position where we only respond to things that reach a level of crisis or emergency. And all it takes is a single person who knows how to hack the electrical grids, build biotech, or deliver nuclear weapons to cause irrevocable damage. Our complexity has made us extremely fragile. So over the last year, I guess the last one, is animals taking over the world. So quite frankly, I think the current debate about AI creating an existential risk is misprioritized. I quite frankly am much more fearful of the damage and destruction that is potentially caused by human behavior. Or as my girlfriend likes to say, we have a 99 problems and an algorithm ain't one. So collectively, humans remain unchanged from thousands of years ago. So over time, the scenery has changed, and through this, quality of life has improved. But when it comes to human behavior, the song remains the same. We've gone from killing each other with stones to murdering each other in mass with automatic weapons. Our technological tools progress exponentially, while human behavior capability has flatlined. So my daughter's fears, it turns out, are pretty similar to mine. It's halftime, and I'm looking at the scoreboard, and I feel uneasy. So I believe humans, individually and collectively, our systems, our thinking, and our ideas are woefully ill-equipped to deal with the future. We are stuck in the Paleolithic age of our cognitive evolution. Now, I realize that some of you may think I'm being overly pessimistic in saying all this, but I want to call a spade a spade. We have very real, very hard problems to solve with no quick and easy answers. In fact, if I were to ask each one of you in this room what you think should be done, I bet you could readily tell me your idea. For example, if we could just get rid of corporate money out of politics, if we could just get everyone to, access to education, if we could just depend upon scientists to solve our problems and hope that our systems don't break in the meantime. Ultimately, any one or all three of these solutions might help us and build a better future, but I can only tell you from what I believe personally, and to be critically important to the advancement of the human race. Everything we are, everything we build, and everything we aspire to become begins with the brain. I believe that if we can understand how the brain works, we might be able to define and overcome the default configuration that leads to the fundamental problems we face as a society. So based upon our current brain technology, such as EEG, MRI, deep brain stimulation, and retinal prostheses, we have quadriplegics that can move robotic arms, allow doctors to image otherwise invisible tumors, allow patients with Parkinson's to ameliorate their tremors, and the blind to see 60 pixels of meaningful light, respectively. So we also have tools readily available to us, like cognitive behavioral therapy, exercise, meditation, and diet, that are all known to reduce anxiety, depression, and a number of mental illnesses. But the question is, are these tools enough? So scale matters. Each one of us has roughly 86 billion neurons. These tools show us the potential of what we can accomplish with access to a minuscule subset of neurons at a time. But what if we could record from and write to millions or billions of neurons? If we could crack the neural code, and that is, if we could read and write the language of our nervous system, could we, lessen devastating disease and dysfunction and proactively monitor our neural health? Could we better manage our internal state and explore vast, untapped potential of the human race? And could we tap into global consciousness and feel what it's like to walk in another person's shoes? Could we enhance our abilities to remember, imagine, communicate, empathize, love, and express creativity? The total cognitive output of humanity is not zero sum. It's potentially infinite. So what, if you had the ability to enhance yourself, what one feature would you improve? My girlfriend says, even with the most powerful form of cognitive tools, that I never could be funny. I don't think she's right. I think I could. And I think we have, I think there's hope for all of us in the things we aspire for. There is no proven ceiling. But honestly, if you ask me what exactly will happen if we actually could develop these tools for what is possible for reading and writing neural code, I don't know. The top neuroscientists in the world don't know. If you ask the larger community in 1872 what electricity might power one day, I highly doubt they would have told you washers and dryers, televisions, and dating apps. So I've laid out the idea. We need to better interface with the brain if we want to consciously evolve as a species. So who's going to fund this endeavor? Who's going to build the tools that are sufficiently powerful on a timescale relevant to our survival? When I looked around, that is why I have built a team of 35 and personally invested $100 million to build the tools that allow these questions to be asked. But it's not enough. So we need, neuroscience is incredibly difficult. We need, it's expensive, it sometimes takes decades to bring these technologies to market. So despite truly impressive discoveries that we have made during the 90s, we've mapped a minuscule portion of the brain and the structure. Your neural code, that is what it is and how it works, is still an alien language. So furthermore, the study of the brain is under-resourced. In the US, the Brain Initiative was funded at 1/3 of 1% of the total NIH budget. Pharma R&D budgets have basically dropped to zero, and antidepressants and antipsychotics are deliveries of other derivatives of old drugs. So we lack effective treatments, let alone cures for a majority of neurological and psychiatric illness. Despite remarkable progress, the harsh realities, the paralyzed still can't walk, the blind still can't see, and the depressed still can't imagine a way out. It's halftime. Time is not necessarily on our side. We need a game plan. So we need more investors. We need more scientists and engineers. We need more storytellers to inspire us in this pursuit. Now is the time to focus on the brain. It's easy for us to point at the moon and say, hey, let's go there. But what do we do if I say, hey, let's go inside here? Let's make neuroscience the new rocket science. I've spoken a lot about fears driving action today. But the reality is that humanity's greatest accomplishments have been achieved when anchored in hope and aspiration. We all have fears. It's embedded in our reptilian brains. We mistakenly and frequently fear low probability events more high than others. I didn't share my burdens with Genevieve. I don't want to burden her already burdened mind. I do, however, want to be able to look at her and my two boys with the utmost confidence and tell them that I did everything in my power to give them a world that they could build upon and deliver to their children. Thank you.